I'm going to talk about something that we as developers are so excited about and focused on when it comes to writing code, which is maintaining it. So I want to focus on what are some of the reasons why we want to really focus on improving the quality of code. And then we'll talk about some ways in which we can improve the quality of code. Along the way, you know, where it makes sense, we'll take a look at a little bit of code as well. But I'm going to talk about quite a few things that I've observed from my experience working with developers, writing code myself. Well, before we go into talking about code quality, let me admit, I'll be absolutely honest about it. And probably you relate to this as well. I am really bad at writing code. I write code that smells really bad. And so every time I write code, I'm like, oh my dear goodness, how do I even show this to anybody? But then I realized that as much as I'm really bad at writing code, I'm extremely good at complaining about other people's code. So what I realized was, this is an amazing real combination. I can write really crappy code and give it to somebody else. And while they kick and scream about it, I can read their code and we both can improve the quality of code at the end of the day. So I've come to the real belief, honestly, that it's impossible to write good quality code in one sitting. Not because we are incompetent, but it's quite the opposite. When we are writing code, we often are focused on the various concepts we are implementing. We are innovating through this code along the way. And as we do, it becomes really hard to focus on the quality of code at the time. So this is one of the reasons why in test-driven development, we were told to do this wonderful thing called red-green refactor. So what is really the red-green refactor? Well, we write the test which fails. We then implement minimum code to make the test to pass. But then we pause for a minute and look at the quality of code, among other things, and see if we can improve the quality of code. That's basically the idea behind improving the quality continuously rather than pretending that we can write the code in the beginning. But of course, you know, one of the questions I like to often ask is why? And the reason I ask why is, maybe if that's not a good compelling reason, I don't have to spend the time on it. I can invest my time and effort elsewhere. So I'm going to start with the question, why should we really care about the quality of code? And I'm going to say, one of the reasons we want to care about the quality of code is we cannot be agile if our code sucks. As simple as that. You know, we all talk about agile development. Well, you want to be able to, you know, respond to change along the way, and especially, you know, towards the end. But you are sitting and talking to your colleagues, and they are telling you that particular feature change is going to touch the XYZ module. And you remember the last time you touched the XYZ module, you couldn't go home for the weekend. You're going to convince them, no, forget about this agility. We're not going to touch that piece of code because nobody comes out alive after touching it. So we are going to push those changes away, and it really hampers our ability to be agile. Well, okay, so that's a fairly good reason. But then I was thinking about it, and then I realized there is one more reason at least why we should really care about the quality of code. And that is, code is how we tell our colleagues how we feel about them. Do we love them or do we hate them all? So this is really coming back to humanity, I think. You know, we care about our neighbors, we care about our family, we care about our friends. Well, we should care about our colleagues as well. And in a way, if you really think about it, you know, what do we do in a civilized society as human beings? You're walking through that door, you push the door open, but ever so gently, probably you don't even realize it these days because you're so used to it, you hold the door just for a moment so it doesn't slam on the person behind you. That is your humanity. Well, guess what? Every time we push the code into the repository, there is always a developer behind us. And we don't want the code to slam on them. So we definitely want to care about humanity. So it comes to really cost of development, if you will. And as it turns out, Lowering quality lengthens the development time, says the first law of programming. So if you really write bad quality code, that directly has an impact on agility. And because it slows us down when we really want to be gaining sustainable speed, if you will. So it really comes to the economic impact. Poor quality code costs us more to develop the code, more to maintain the code, more to use the code as well. And besides the human aspect of things that we talked about. So we want to definitely take care of the good quality code for those good reasons. But the question really then comes to, what is quality? And here's the challenge, right? You ask 15 people what quality is, chances are you'll get more than 15 answers about what quality means. Because one thing common in our industry, in our industry is, no two people can agree on the same thing oftentimes. So we keep debating about things. But I would take almost any definition of what quality is, other than the one I got from a developer not too long ago. He said, this code is great because I wrote it. I don't think that's a good definition. I don't think we can claim quality based on that person, especially the one who is claiming to have written it, saying that it's of good quality. Well, everybody has different definition, but here's my definition of what quality of code really is. Quality of code, the quality of code is inversely proportional to the amount of time and effort it takes to understand it. If you take more time to understand, more effort to understand a piece of code, it's a reflection of poor quality. If we take less time to understand a piece of code, assuming we do have the context of the domain and the application, then of course it's a better quality code. So we want to strive to really create better quality code as much as we can, and with that definition of quality. So what are some of the ways in which we can improve the quality of code? Well, the first one I'm going to say is to honor the SLAP principle. I'm going to entertain this, if you don't mind, if you will. Would you please do me a favor? On the chat, I want you to type either the word yes or the word no. Only two words, one of the two words. So do you believe writing long functions is a good idea? So if you think writing long functions are a good idea, put a no, otherwise yes. Oh, I see no flowing through that. Thank you so much for the response. Usually there's one person who says yes, or maybe somebody says it depends. There you go, Adele. I caught you right there, didn't I? What a coincidence. I think we were twins separated at birth because I can read your mind from here. Well, absolutely. You know, it depends is usually a good answer in computer programming, but the answer is an overwhelming no. Okay, erase that question for a minute. Reset your mind. Let me ask you a completely different question. Have you seen long functions at work? Yes or no? If you've seen long functions at work, and notice the difference here, right? We went from a no answers all the way to a yes answer with even a sad face in one of those replies. And that's real. And not too many is a good thing to be in. That's a good thing. And so this is called cognitive dissonance. So what is cognitive dissonance? It is knowing one thing and doing something else and having a hard time realizing why we are doing it. But of course, I have a good news for you. The long functions you're seeing at work, you didn't write it because you just told me a few minutes ago, you don't believe writing those long functions, right? But the problem is those who are writing the long functions are at work today, making those functions longer as we speak. So the question is, what can we do to prevent it? And I'm going to say this is a disease in our industry because we see long functions all the time, but long function is not the length of the function. You know, sometimes people ask me, what do you mean long? Well, you know, is long too long, not too long? Is 1,000 lines long? Is 100 lines long? How do we define it? One person said, a function is not long if you can see the entire function in a window. And the minute this person said, somebody said, what's your font size? Even there, we cannot agree on what the length is. As it turns out, it's the length of the function is not actually the number of lines. but the levels of nesting or the indentation. I'm going to give you an absolutely silly example for this. Imagine you go to work on Monday. I can only imagine right now with the pandemic, but imagine you're at work on Monday and a colleague comes to you and says, hey, how was your weekend? Maybe this colleague is a person who writes really good code, and you can tell this colleague, oh, the weekend was great. I went to the park on Sunday, went to the movies on Saturday. But if this colleague is the one who writes long functions, then answer it like this. You look at the person who writes long function and says, oh, my weekend. At 7 a.m. on Saturday, I pulled the car out of the garage, took a left turn, drove for 3 kilometers, took a right turn, drove for 4 kilometers, took a right turn. That's when I noticed they had a detour. I had to make a turn and come all the way. And then I took a left turn. Just keep going like this for a while. At some point, your colleague will say, excuse me, have you gone mad? And you say, no, I thought I would tell you how my weekend was, like the way you write code. And the point really is, we don't communicate with people in those details. Instead, we give them knowledge chunks. Hey, how was your weekend? Oh, the weekend was great. Saturday went to the park, Sunday went to the movies. Really? Which park did you go to on Saturday? Oh, the one by the main street. Of course, I've learned about that before. So tell me a little bit about that park. Is it family friendly? Oh, I took entire family over there. Well, what are we getting to at this point? Well, this is exactly what's called the SLAP principle, which stands for single level of abstraction, as Jakob is pointing out in the chat. So essentially, this is a single level of abstraction principle. So you want to focus on every single function to be in one level of abstraction. I don't really mind if a function is 20, 30 lines long as all the functions are in a single level. This takes to what is called the composed method pattern. The composed method pattern is where the methods are composed at one level of abstraction. Now you may say, okay, Venkat, but we all know this, isn't it? Well, yes, we do, but knowing is very different from doing, as we have all seen. And if we can go back with a renewed interest, I think we can convince our colleagues and sometimes even ourselves to write code which is focused on a single level of abstraction, and that is something we can definitely do. So as a result, of course, we want to focus on minimizing the number of levels, and as a result, it has impact on complexity of the code as well. Talking about complexity, one of the other things to think about is we want the code to have high cohesion and loose coupling. Now, of course, cohesion is where a piece of code is narrow, focused, and does one thing and one thing really well. So you want the code to be cohesive. And talking about cohesive, you also want to reduce coupling. And where possible, we want to eliminate coupling. Now, let's think about this for a minute. You know, my parents really tried hard to teach me cohesion when I was a child and a youth. And they tried really hard. And I'm almost in tears saying this, because they were really good people. They tried really hard, but they could never really make me better at that point. And I would come back from school and I would throw things to, you know, wherever I want them to be. I'll open a, you know, cupboard and throw things in there. If you ever open it, I can guarantee what you will see. Maybe snakes come out of it. Who knows? Because everything is a pile of trash in there. It was optimized for throwing things in, not optimized to take things out. So if I ever wanted a blue sock, I won't know when I'll find the other one. And it was a mess to deal with. And of course, you know, they said, hey, you put your books in one place, you put your sock in another place, you put your utensil in another place. But I could never see why you may want to waste your time doing that, because it was much fun to throw things together, isn't it? Well, years later, when I came to software, is when the term hit my head. Oh my goodness, this is called cohesion. And my parents were always trying to teach me cohesion. Put like things together and unlike things apart from each other. That's basically what we are doing here, is to be cohesive. And of course, keeping code cohesive and lowering coupling has a direct impact on reducing the accidental complexity in the code, and that can help us to bring that complexity to manageable level. So we end up really dealing with the inherent complexity of the application and not be driven by the accidental complexity that we often have to endure the pain about. So we can talk about the SLAP principle, focusing on level of abstraction, bring in high cohesion and coupling. But then one of the things we really need to do is to slow down. And I'm going to use the word again, is to slow down and write code with intention. And if you ask me what that slowing down for me is, oftentimes that slowing down for me is writing automated tests before I write the code. Because an automated test slows me down and says, Venkat, I know you are intelligent, you are smart as any human being is, but slow down. You're trying to jump too far ahead into a solution. Think a little bit about somebody who's going to read your code by way of these test cases. So the test cases give me an opportunity to fit into the shoes of somebody who's going to use the code I'm writing. That's empathy right there, isn't it? So test actually brings empathy about the people who are going to end up using the code, and you want them to be your friends and not victims eventually. And it tells you, hey, let's try to really think about how they would use the code, and then think about, you know, if the intention is revealed in the code we are writing, is it expressive? So revealing intention is one of the things we should really strive for. And Ken Beck talks about this in his four rules of simple design. So if you Google for, you know, Ken Beck, and then if you Google for the words four rules of simple design, you will find it. And it's a pretty interesting observation as to how we can really think about, you know, writing better quality code. And he says the code should pass all tests. But the second thing he says is the code reveals intention. So that is something we try to really do, is to reveal the intention in the code. And when we talk about intention of the code, it comes in naming variables. It comes in naming functions. It comes in naming classes. It comes in the flow of the code as well. And that is something really important to keep in mind. It's just not the variable name alone, but it also comes to the flow of the code. So if you really think about, you know, revealing intention, I'm going to say it is, you know, variable names, for example. Then it is, of course, the function names. It is also the class names that you are creating. But more important is the flow in the code also. That makes a huge difference. Because if the code has a nice flow, it reveals the intention. You are kind of setting up the things to anticipate for the reader, and you and the reader of the code are in harmony, walking with each other. But if you do random stuff in the code, not because you are intentionally doing it, it's because you know the idea, you're putting it in the code, but the reader is completely lost, saying, what's happening in this code? Also, we don't, you know, honoring encapsulation or following the law of Demeter, for example, can be really useful as well. So what you really want to do is to focus on not just the variable names alone, but the law of Demeter is really important, where we, again, work towards what the user of the code is expecting, and have that nice flow along the way becomes very critical. The next thing I want to say here is avoid primitive obsession. We as developers are really, really keen on writing the code when we should really be using higher level abstraction that's available. Let's take an example of what that means really quickly here. If a code here says, given an N and a K, it says compute the total of the square root of the first K prime numbers. Hey, that's not rocket science. A very simple problem, isn't it? But how do you implement this code? You may say something like, for example, double result is equal to zero. And you may say int index is equal to n, int count is equal to, you know, starting with a zero. Then you say along the lines, return the result when you are done. Then you may say while count is less than k. And then it comes to a thing called, you ask the question, is it less than K or is it less than or equal to K? How many times do we bother with that? Is it less than or equal to K? Then you may say in this case, if the is prime of the index is true, then you may say, hey, result is going to be maybe plus equal to math dot square root of, for example, the index. Then you say, you better increment the count. Then you say, you better increment the index, you say. And then I'm going to ask you, is this code correct? And you're going to say, no, it's not correct. The increment has to come outside. So I say, okay, no problem, move it outside. Then you say, oh, no. One half of them should be inside. The other should be outside. Well, which one should go inside? You move the count inside, and then you wonder, is this really correct? No, no, what is this code? Is it correct now? And we're still not sure because we are staring at it. You know, I love words. People will look at code like this and they will tell you, let me figure it out. Now, why are they saying, let me figure it out? Because I have no clue what the code is doing that is hidden in the code. Well, this is called accidental complexity, where you're writing code at the lowest level. Let's give it a try again, rather than writing the code like that. Let's go ahead and say, this is one of the reasons why I love functional style of programming. I can say return a stream, if you will, dot iterate. And in the iterate function, it does help to spell iterate properly, iterate. And what are we going to do in the iterate? Start with the n, give a number, give me the number plus one. Then I say filter and give me only the even numbers, please. Or rather, give me only the prime numbers, please. And I'm going to say is prime. Then I say limit this to k values, please. And notice we're not asking, is it k or less than k or less than or equal to k? It's that clear and simple. We remove the accidental complexity from the code. And then you say math to double. And in this case, of course, I'm going to say math square root of that operation and perform a sum on it. And the code becomes extremely easy to write. You don't have to deal with the complexity. And there you see the result of that computation. Now, this removes the burden from us by removing the accidental complexity in the code. And it helps us to make sure the code is beginning to read like the problem statement. So that is one of the things we should strive to attain, is to remove all that burden of the primitive obsession and write code at a higher level of abstraction. Well, two other things I want to really talk about is something we all have done before, which is to write clever code. Now, I'm not even going to ask you if you have written clever code, because that's the first requirement of being a programmer, isn't it? We all love writing clever code. So we write clever code, but the question you want to ask is, why do we write clever code? I'll be very honest about it. We write clever code because it feels good. It feels like we are special. You show a code to a colleague, your colleague looks at you and says, yeah, that's simple, I understand. We feel a little let down. Let me come back tomorrow. We take another version of the code and they look at the code and say, oh my goodness, it works. But how does it do? What kind of masking are you doing on this? And then we can sit over lunch and talk about how cool this implementation was. And then you go home and tell your parents, you know, parents, I wrote this code, and they kind of watch you and they say, and you say, it worked, and nobody understands it. And the parents are like, I know you're going to be brilliant one day, and they pat you in the back, right? Well, that's kind of misguided. So really, you know, as Einstein said, any intelligent fool can create something violent and complex. But he said, it takes a touch of genius to create something that is simple. So the pride is in creating code others can understand. Now, I've learned my lesson the hard way. I used to write a lot of clever code, and almost every single time it came to bite me in the back. These days, when I look at a clever code, and a cool clever code, there's an example being posted on the chat as well, and there are several of those we can take a look at it. But the point really is, when I write my clever code, it really taught me the lesson. These days, when I write clever code, I immediately delete it. And I start writing clear code, because that's what really is maintainable, not the cleverness we could really bring about. And that becomes really a problem. And finally, of course, one of the things I want to mention here is comment why and not the what. And this is something to really think about. We have a culture in our societies as programmer culture, is we are forced to start writing comments. But that leads to obsolete comments, comments that are hard to maintain over time. And I'm really not a fan of comments that tell me what the code is doing, but I really want the comment that tells me why the code exists. Tell me the things I don't really see. Those are the things we want to focus on. A good quality of code is the one that is self-documenting, self-describing. And the comments there are telling us what to watch out and why those things are done, not what the code is doing. And we can create better quality code where the comments that are telling us what become obsolete. To the point, when somebody tells me today, this code is hard to understand, let's write a comment. I say, time out. This code is hard to understand. Let's go ahead and refactor the code. So a bad code deserves refactoring, not commenting. And that is something to really keep in mind. And of course, names. You know, they say names are one of the most difficult things for us to do as programmers. Why? Partly because we are struggling to understand the problem as we are trying to implement it. But also partly because I'm also beginning to believe this more and more, is that it actually is a cultural issue a lot more than an issue really related to technology or technical things. So culturally, we tend to really write bad code quite often. Now, this is where I think along the way, we'd never had mentors who bothered enough to tell us, hey, let's not write code like that. Let's write code in a meaningful way. And part of the reason for the problem, I have to say, is the P word, not the programmers, but the professors. But before I tell you that, let me clarify this. I work in the industry, but I also teach at the university. I've been a professor of computer science for a little bit more than 30 years now. And I tell you, the professors are the first to be blamed because what do they say? Hey, your code works. Here's the score for you. Well, hey, is the code good quality? They say, I don't care. And then when they look at the code, they say, every 5 lines of code, we need a comment. So they've been teaching us bad practices for decades. And then we go to the industry. You say, oh, wait, but in the industry, we don't have professors, thankfully. Oh, that's true. But we have the corporate police who say, here's our coding standard. You need to have comments. Otherwise, no bonus for you. Now we are forced to practice bad things over time, and we don't even get a taste of what it may be without it. So in other words, we want to really think about good quality code in terms of names of variables too. But things have gotten only worse, as you may have noticed, is with the lambda expressions. What do people do with lambdas, right? So you have, you know, some instance dot some function, and then you have a lambda. And what do people do in this case? In this case, you say, you know, X arrow and then something. I don't have a clue why it has to be X, but people like to put X. If not, it is a Y. If not, it is a W or a K or some random set of stuff people keep putting. I mean, would you do this, honestly? Would you name your child P? I mean, they come to the child and say, what's your name, honey? My name is P. Is that an initial? Oh, no, my full name is P. Well, the only thing I can think of when a child has a name called P is both the parents are programmers. Otherwise, that would not have happened, isn't it? And the absence of maybe grandparents who are there to protect the child's name. So the point really is we shouldn't really come up with names like this. In fact, one day I was very curious. I wanted to find out what the next name of the variable will be in here in this case, right? And I don't know what the name would be. Maybe I can find a pattern here. Or even worse, what if my colleague was abducted and is being held hostage? Maybe, and they're only allowed to write the code, so nobody knows they've been abducted. Maybe my colleague is trying to send me in secret the location where they're being hidden by way of these names. I'll try to do a pattern matching to find it too. Alas, no such thing. But the point really is, that's a disservice when we write the code like that. We definitely want to have a good name for variables because names represent abstraction. And using those names, we can make use of what those things mean. It becomes easier for the readers of the code to understand and to maintain that code as well. And so it's our professional responsibility to give good names for variables, classes, methods, and so on. But in all honesty, I'll admit to you, I can never give good names of things myself when I sit down to write it, but I'm receptive to my code reviewers. When I pair up, my colleague usually is the one that says, hey, what does that name mean? I'm like, I don't know. So that's another way we can improve the quality of code. So we talked about a number of things. And the last thing I'll quickly mention is do tactical code reviews. Now, some of us don't like the word code reviews, but I really like tactical code reviews. But what in the world does tactical code review mean? Well, I write code, one other colleague reviews it, and we rotate among people for this review. And we don't try to bring the entire team into a room and review the code because it becomes a really a nightmare for everybody involved. But we also, I also not only review the code, but I start reviewing the test first, and then I review the code. And as a result, I can keep an eye on the quality of test as much as the quality of code as well. And when I review the code, when I find a bug, I like to write a test as well, rather than asking the question. We don't have to worry about a lot of these details. Yes, we do. A good practice is to write that test while we are writing, fixing a bug. And that is something we need to really take care of it as well. So we talked about a number of ways in which we can improve the quality of code. But what good is all of that if we cannot follow that? And that's where I think each one of us come into the play, is we can influence organizations and teams we work in, so we can actually help to promote the quality of code.